Okay, for about the next 20 minutes, we're going to review the recognition and treatment of medical emergencies in the setting of the dental office. So we'll discuss general principles of management. We'll analyze selected cases for the more commonly observed emergencies and review the design and contents of an office emergency kit. It's important to remember that EMS response time varies quite a bit. An average of 10 or 11 minutes in an urban area, 15 minutes in a rural area, and it's often been stated that in the dental office you need to be prepared to potentially manage a patient for up to 30 minutes. Focus should always be on number one, prevention, number two, preparedness. So in terms of prevention, it only takes 30 seconds to review that patient's medical history and maybe address a few specific questions. So for the cardiac patient, you might just want to ask if they experienced any problems with chest pain, shortness of breath, or such. For the asthmatic, if they had any problems, when was their last attack, did they have their inhaler, and so forth. Just spend the first minute of any visit doing that. And then periodic drills will be essential, because a common theme with poor outcomes in many cases that I've reviewed is always pandemonium in the face of an emergency. So mock drills where medications are actually retrieved, when our oxygen is applied to a mock patient, these become essential. And then keep a record of those drills because you may be asked to produce it later. Who might ask for it? Well, if there's a bad outcome, it could be the dental board, or it could be a malpractice attorney that might ask for a record of your drills. And then for any emergency, remember the ABCs. It forces you to stop, think, and just assess things systematically. So the ABCs, airway, is the airway open? B, breathing, is the patient breathing on their own, or do we have to assist this? And then C, circulation, assess the vital signs. What's the character and rate of the pulse? What is the blood pressure? And then D, defibrillation, of course, comes first in a known cardiac collapse or a BLS rescue. But in general, just revert to the ABCs. It slows us down, forces us to think systematically. Also, the team response is going to be critical. So in any office-based response, there really should be three team members. The team leader would typically be the dentist, who would lead and direct the response. Team two would be the assistant, who will retrieve emergency kit and drugs and take directions from the leader in terms of other assistance. And then team three is also critical. This would be typically reception staff or another individual who can summon the medical assistants, direct them when they get there, and then just circulate and fill in as needed. So let's look at the first case. This is a 68-year-old female. She takes Lipitor, Acifex, and a beta blocker. You're finishing up a MOD-BL amalgam. Should have been a crown. You're upset about that. Finishing off the final condensing. Patient says she feels sweaty. She wants to sit up. She thinks it's reflux. What do you think? Well, now she says, my chest hurts. I forgot to tell you I take nitroglycerin. What do you think now? So you revert to the ABCs, you assess the vitals. The blood pressure is 105 over 62. Hopefully you took it at the start of the procedure and you've noted that blood pressure has actually dropped. The pulse is weak and thready at a rate of 64. So this certainly looks like chest pain, angina. We're going to think about nitroglycerin, potentially aspirin, and oxygen. The question always comes up in a situation like this, when do you transport? Well, certainly if this is a new complaint, if it's not relieved by nitroglycerin, or if vital signs deteriorate, that would be a case for immediate transport. If the patient recognizes that this is something she experiences with some frequency, and if it's relieved by the nitroglycerin, then that patient may be able to be discharged to home. But that obviously will vary. And then avoidance is critical. So we mentioned taking the history. If you know you have a somewhat fragile cardiac patient, supplemental oxygen could be used, semi-Fowler's position, even prophylactic nitroglycerin. If they take it with some regularity, no reason why they can't take it before their appointment. And then we have to think about the progression from angina to myocardial infarction and potentially to cardiac arrest. So with angina, just to review again, we would terminate the procedure, position the patient comfortably, give supplemental oxygen, nitroglycerin, either the patient's own or from our emergency kit. The nitroglycerin can be repeated up to 3 times every 5 minutes. And if no response, then we're going to expect that this may have progressed or may be progressing to an MI, and we'll activate the EMS, emergency medical system, immediately. It's important to remember there are a couple contraindications to nitroglycerin. It may cause hypotension, so a patient who is very hypotensive should probably not be given nitroglycerin. It's also contraindicated with Viagra and related medications, again, because profound hypotension may ensue. Symptoms of myocardial infarction, in contradistinction from angina, well, the same signs and symptoms may present initially, but if we're concerned about progression to we would be concerned about progression to myocardial infarction if it's unresponsive to nitroglycerin. If there is diaphoresis and dyspnea, so sweating, shortness of breath, sense of impending doom is also sometimes described by patients who are about to experience or are experiencing an MI, and the vital signs may deteriorate. Typically, blood pressure will fall. The treatment for myocardial infarction, the mnemonic is MONA, M is morphine, O is oxygen, N is nitroglycerin, and A is aspirin. So we would position the patient comfortably, administer nitroglycerin, supplemental oxygen. If it's in the kit, morphine. If it's not, we'll discuss an alternative in just a moment. Aspirin, patient can chew a tablet, 325 milligrams, monitor the vital signs, and call for EMS. Now, many emergency kits won't have morphine, but virtually any dental office will have nitrous oxide, which actually is an excellent analgesic and can also be used in this setting. In terms of oxygen sources, they should generally be mobile. The E-tank, which you see on the left side of the screen, is ideal. If the patient's in there in the dental chair and there's an attached nitrous and oxygen unit, certainly that can be used as well. But in any situation, we have to be able to provide positive pressure ventilation. So something like an AMBU bag, which you see on the right side of the screen, will be a part of all emergency kits within the school. All right, so let's look at the next case. This is a ASA1 patient for cementation of a crown on tooth number 15. You're unseating it for the last adjustment when suddenly it slips alongside the tongue. You lose it, can no longer see it. The patient then coughs 7 or 8 times, repeated forceful coughs, stops coughing, now says it feels funny in his throat, but there's no further coughing. So what do you think? Where is it, and what do we do? Well, some of the things we have to think about, besides where is it, when do we x-ray? We certainly should talk about prevention and recognize that this is not an infrequent occurrence, either within the school of dentistry or on the outside, where it's actually a common source of malpractice claims. Now, we can't assume that it's in the gut just because the patient stopped coughing. It may still have been aspirated. And in fact, this is one such case where a nearly identical clinical scenario occurred. It was thought that because the patient stopped coughing, he could be discharged. That patient actually showed up in the emergency room about a week later with an acute lung abscess, and you can see that there is a crown, a foreign body, in the right lung field. So complications could occur, whether it's aspiration or whether it was swallowed. If it's aspirated, an immediate complication could be laryngospasm with an acute airway obstruction, or, as you just saw, infection and lung abscess if it's unrecognized and patient is discharged. If it's swallowed, most objects will pass uneventfully. It depends obviously on the size and shape of the foreign body, but potential complications would be GI obstruction, abscess, or even bowel perforation if something becomes lodged. So in terms of the immediate management, if we're quite certain it's swallowed, we're still going to get a chest x-ray and a flat plate of the abdomen to localize it. And then if it's confirmed that it's in the GI system, we'll either strain stools, or the patient needs to do that and recover the object, or we'll repeat the abdominal film after 3 or 4 days. If it's aspirated and lodged, or if you're not sure where it went, well, Trendelenburg position with the head lower than feet would be good. Encourage coughing. You could consider using a McGill forceps if that's part of your kit. You can see that on the right side. That's the McGill forceps. If there's total obstruction, respiratory distress and total obstruction, the Heimlich maneuver, and you could also consider cricothyroidotomy if the Heimlich maneuver is not working. Now, you might think I could never perform that. I'm not trained to do that. But actually, there are numerous reports of this being done in the field by people with relatively scant training. So if you just localize the thyroid cartilage, which is the largest, the Adam's apple, palpate the ligament right underneath that before the next cartilage underneath it, which would be the cricoid. The cricothyroid ligament is right between the two. And if you have a cricoid punch as part of your emergency kit, such as you see on the right side of the screen, then that could truly be a life-saving procedure if there's absolute airway obstruction. And just to illustrate the extent to which some people will go to achieve tenure and to publish, there was actually an emergency physician who studied what the best pen would be for cricothyroidotomy. And so if you want to be a hero, you need to carry either the Baron retractable ballpoint or the Bic soft field jumbo. That study was actually done and published in 2010. Just to review the protocol here at the School of Dentistry, a flat plate of the abdomen and a chest x-ray would be obtained for any lost foreign body. Again, if it's in the abdomen, we'll prescribe a high bulk diet and then either repeat the film or the patient has to do homework to retrieve that. If it's in the chest, it requires bronchoscopy to retrieve it on an urgent basis. Prevention, I think this should be a largely preventable complication. Always use mouth screen for extractions. I think even in many crown cementations, it can be used perhaps more than it is. Rubber dam whenever possible, and tie floss to files or other small implant components when a rubber dam is not in use. Okay, case 3. This is a 45-year-old female, extremely anxious patient. She is on Zoloft and Clonopin, a new patient. While obtaining the medical history, the patient tells you she isn't feeling well. You notice her eyes rolling back, and she suddenly slumps back in the chair. So what's your diagnosis and treatment here? Well, certainly we're going to put syncope right at the top of the list. It seems like a classic case of that. That's the most common emergency we'll encounter in the dental office. So we'll position the patient with the head back. We'll administer oxygen, immediately assess the vital signs, perhaps apply a cold towel to the head, and then always resort to the ABCs, so we're going to support the airway. Other signs of syncope would include pallor, perspiration. If you're focused only on the oral cavity, sometimes the first sign will actually be beads forming on the palate. It's been described, and that's something that I've seen personally. A slow and weak pulse, low blood pressure. If it's not recognized early enough and managed early enough, these patients may have mini seizure due to inadequate blood flow to the brain. In terms of prevention, obviously we want to minimize pain and anxiety, keep needles out of sight, always consider hypoglycemia as a cause. And then it becomes important to think about, when is syncope not just syncope? So when is it not just an uncomplicated vasovagal reaction? And in this regard, consider the medical history. If there's any underlying condition, then we have to suspect that perhaps this is more than just a uncomplicated syncopal reaction. And then when the patient fails to recover quickly, uncomplicated vasovagal reaction is generally self-limiting with proper management. So if the patient does not recover quickly, then we have to be thinking about other causes. What could other causes of altered consciousness be? Well, stroke could be an acute cardiovascular event. So again, consider the patient history. Could be drug overdose, hyper or hypoglycemia. Uncontrolled hypothyroidism would be quite rare. And anaphylactic shock, if untreated, could also result in loss of consciousness and cardiac arrest. Okay, case four. It's the end of the day. The office is nearly empty. It's just you being an assistant. There's one other assistant present. The doctor is left. Cleanup is in progress. The mother of your last patient runs in frantically, tells you, "My husband just collapsed in the waiting room. Someone please help." So you rush to the scene. You find the individual, now your patient, slumped over two chairs. So what do you do? Well, we now obviously have a BLS, basic life support rescue situation. Remember that ABCD is now DCAB because the emphasis is on early chest compression and defibrillation. So you activate the EMS, obtain or call for the defibrillator. If there's no pulse, you start chest compressions. Current guidelines call for a compression to rescue breath ratio of 30-2 and a compression chest compression rate of 100-120 per minute. It's been stated that compression rate, if you're not sure what that rhythm should be, that it roughly corresponds to the beat of the song Stayin' Alive. So think John Travolta, Stayin' Alive, and that's roughly the compression rate that you should follow. You really need to be familiar with the defibrillator and where the pads are placed. So one is placed on the right side, patient's right side, above the nipple. The other is placed on the patient's left side in the mid-axillary line. And as part of your drills, you should remove and actually position those so that you're familiar with how to do it. Case 5. This is a 71-year-old female in for prophylaxis and forgot to take her required pre-med. She is allergic to penicillin, had a severe rash last time she took penicillin. You instruct the assistant to give 150 milligrams of clindamycin, 4 tablets. About 20 minutes later, the patient was in the waiting room. She tells the receptionist, "I feel like my throat is closing." You go to the waiting area, the patient appears flushed, the eyes are swollen, hands also swollen, there's a very rapid pulse noted, and the assistant now realizes and confesses, I gave 4 amoxicillin tablets by mistake. This incident actually occurred in the office of a new-to-practice dentist. So obviously we have an acute allergic reaction here, and we need to distinguish between mild allergy, such as the angioneurotic edema or lip swelling that you might get from a reaction to prophy paste, distinguish that from, or a mild rash from a drug occurring after 24 hours, distinguish that from severe reaction, a true anaphylactic response with difficulty breathing, visible swelling, hypotension, and ultimately there will be cardiac collapse if it's not treated. So the first line drug for acute allergy is epinephrine, and it can either be given 0.5 to 1 milligram of a 1 to 1,000 concentration, or if an intravenous line happens to be present, it can also be given intravenously 1 to 10,000 concentration. But most of the packs here in the dental school will have the EpiPen preloaded for even more convenient use. Secondary drugs for management of allergy are Benadryl, 25 to 50 milligrams, either PO or parenterally, also part of the basic kits here, and steroids for secondary management. So again, here we have the EpiPen, which will be the easiest to use, and the 2 concentrations of epinephrine, 1 to 10,000. That's usually used for cardiac applications in a patient who has an IV running, and 1 to 1,000, which again could be drawn up and given for acute allergic reaction. Instructions on the EpiPen are with all of the devices, and virtually anyone should be able to administer that. I want to say a little bit about diabetic emergencies. So which is more dangerous in the acute condition? Is it hyper or hypo? And it's actually hypoglycemia that would be the most potentially dangerous. Usually presents with nausea, diaphoresis or sweating, tachycardia, and patients will generally recognize that it's occurring. If they're diabetics, they know the symptoms. Hyperglycemia may be similar in presentation, but you may also notice a fruity breath from the ketones. Eventually, this will progress to true diabetic coma. It's going to be rare to see a patient in the outpatient setting with the true hyperglycemic emergency. So if you were in doubt, you could always treat for hypoglycemia. That would be a reasonable thing to do. With glucometers, we should be able to recognize it both by history and confirm it with a glucometer. Management includes, again, attention to the ABCs. If the patient is conscious, they can be given orally a sugar or carbohydrate source, candy or juice. If they're somewhat obtunded or unconscious, transmucosal sugar products, the paste, is part of all of the emergency kits. Or if you're trained or can obtain an IV, then 50% dextrose intravenously. Seizures. Seizures should be rare in the well-controlled patient who is compliant with medications. Avoidance is going to be key, so any patient with a seizure disorder, when they sit in the chair, ask them, when was their last seizure? What brought it on? Have they taken their meds? If there's any uncertainty, the patient doesn't necessarily have to be treated that day. There's not much that can be done in the event of a witnessed seizure other than protect yourself and protect the patient. So it would be quite recognizable, the eyes roll back and the patient convulses. People feel differently about whether or not to use the padded tongue blade or products such as this, but In any case, you protect the patient as best you can, protect yourself, and it's important to observe the patient post-ictal or after the seizure because they may have variable states of confusion, sometimes sedation or excitement, and they may remain obtunded for some period of time. You may have to support the airway. If you were lucky enough to have an IV in place, you could give Valium. If the IV is not in place, you're certainly not going to get one while the patient is seizing. Stroke, recognition of stroke. Sudden weakness of the face or arm, especially unilateral. Sudden onset of confusion, trouble speaking. Gait disturbance, may also manifest severe headache with no apparent cause, and visual changes. The treatment for a stroke is to activate the EMS. Early intervention is key because fibrinolytic therapy, if indicated, will be critical. Waiting for EMS, supportive therapy with oxygen, and monitor the vital signs. The question always comes up, should aspirin be given with suspected stroke? And the answer is no, because remember that strokes can be either hemorrhagic, that is, due to a bleed in the brain, or they can be obstructive. So if it's obstructive, then something like fibrinolytic therapy or aspirin would be helpful. But if it's hemorrhagic, then aspirin is not indicated. So in the field, we don't give aspirin with suspected stroke. Remember the mnemonic FAST. So F is face, is there facial droop? A is arms, is there arm drift? S is speech, is the speech slurred? And T is time, time to call EMT, and also time to note the time, because whether or not fibrinolytic therapy is given in the hospital will depend on the time of onset of the stroke. So you should monitor the time of onset and record it. Asthmatic emergencies, again with a good history, pre-treating the labile asthmatic with an inhaler should be largely avoidable. Albuterol belongs in any GP emergency kit. There's no reason why, again, that labile patient can't be pre-treated. Severe or refractory cases of asthmatic attack, if it's not responding to albuterol, then epinephrine becomes the drug of choice in that setting. So let's talk a little bit about the emergency kits and some of the pros and cons of the pre-packaged kits. Well, the pros are they're very convenient. There's no need to worry about expiration and restocking because the meds, as they expire, are sent to you automatically, but that convenience comes with a cost. I think it actually comes with two costs. One is the expense. It will be more expensive, but there's also a cost in terms of the convenience, meaning that staff will have less familiarity with the actual contents of the kit. I've seen too many of these in doing office reviews over the years where they sit in the back collecting dust, and it just breeds a lack of familiarity with the kit. So whatever you use, know what's in your kit and know how to use it. Bring it out for the drills. Something we do in our department is organize medications according to emergency. So in this case, they're organized alphabetically. So we have allergy here. We have bronchospasm here, hypo and hypertension down here, and in each of those bins is the drug that will be used, and also attached to the medication is a dosage card. So there's no excuse, even in the face of the crisis situation, the doses are there and the drug should be readily retrievable. Critical items that I think for any drug kit, so this would apply to the general practice kits, and this actually is what's basically in all of those kits. So we have access to the cardiac defibrillator, we have epinephrine, we have needles and syringes, or preloaded syringes, as the case may be, Benadryl tablets and parenteral Benadryl, nitroglycerin, aspirin, a concentrated glucose product, glucose paste, albuterol inhaler, and then oxygen delivery system, including the ability to give positive pressure oxygen. Additional or supplemental items that you might consider: an anticonvulsant like Valium, corticosteroid, morphine, and a cricothyroidotomy kit. Certainly anyone who's doing sedation, so in the clinics where sedation is being used, that raises the bar entirely. So in addition to the previously mentioned items, a McGill forceps and laryngoscope for emergency intubation, pharyngeal suction, which you see on the right side of the screen, tourniquets, additional airway adjuncts, both oral, nasal, and endotracheal tubes, and then drug reversal agents, Narcan for narcotics, flumazenil for drugs like Versed or Valium. So again, important point is the use of office-based sedation raises the bar for the emergency drug kit to an entirely different level. And finally, can't emphasize enough the fact that preparation and simulated training will prepare you for the real thing. So staff and doctor cannot be expected to respond well in emergency unless it's been rehearsed.